Now, everywhere in the world, we're seeing central banks party, making massive liquidity injections in a bid to prop up ailing economies. Now, how far is the Philippine Central Bank willing to go, and what are the risks of shutting down the party? Philippine Central Bank Governor Ben Jokno now joins us this morning. Hi, Gov. Good morning.
Good morning, Mimi, and good morning to our televiewers.
Okay, so Gov, I imagine you are going to play a very critical role as the president builds his economic legacy. How far is the central bank willing to go in an effort to reflate some assets in the hopes that, you know, this would translate eventually to growth and jobs?
Well, I think we have already done at the moment significant moves to increase liquidity into the system and to take care that banks continue to service function in this pandemic. And so, as I said, we pause a little bit at this time to see that the measures that we've done is absorbed by the financial sector and the economy. The most recent one that we've done, by the way, is that we reduced by 1 percentage point or 100 basis points the reserve requirement for 3 in rural banks. That is a big help for them, because as you know, they are the biggest lender to micro, small, and medium enterprises. And that 1 percentage point or 100 basis points cut translated to 10 billion additional resources going to 3 and rural banks.
Mm-hmm. But Governor, how are our rural banks doing today?
I think the central bank has done their job in the past, and by and large they are doing well. They have they're adequately capitalized, and so they pass all the metrics that we have required them to pass, and so for example, rural banks right now, the total assets was at 243 billion as of end March 2020. That's up by 5.6% compared to last year. Mm-hmm. Total deposits of the rural banks, not including the three banks, was 173.6 billion, up by 5.8% compared to last year. So they have a capital adequacy ratio of 19.4%. The requirement is, our requirement is 10%. And an international requirement is 8%. So they're doing pretty well at the moment.
Would you say, Gov, that the rural banks here in the Philippines are facing somehow a higher risk for balance sheet risk versus universal banks? Or are you possibly looking at closures or consolidation in the space?
We, of course, given the reach of the big banks, they are now moving into first, second, third class municipalities, so that is a risk for them. But they're still on the net, they are profitable. But as in the past, we always encourage them to consolidate. We want small rural banks to form bigger rural banks by consolidating. Mm-hmm.
By consolidating, Gov, do you mean smaller banks grouping together, or the big banks taking over some of these rural banks? Like the BDO, for example, BDO bought a rural bank last year. The BPI, of course, investing in a microfinance bank in Rizal a couple of years ago as well.
Both. A universal commercial bank buying some rural banks, or some rural banks combining, joining together to form a bigger rural bank. Mm-hmm. Both are encouraged. Mm-hmm.
Gov, we've started to see companies make the beeline to bond markets as well, scrambling to raise money to stay afloat. But given the expectation of slowing cash flow growth that will soon manifest in corporate earnings if they haven't yet, are we putting too much leverage on these balance sheets?
You know, there are a number of private companies now floating bonds, not only financial institutions, but also some big conglomerates. And this is, I can attribute this, number one, to the declining interest rates globally and domestically. This is part of the move by central bank to increase liquidity into the system, and also by cutting interest rates, so that now it makes more sense for them to float their own bonds and some what they call sustainability bonds. For example, just recently BPI floated, I think, $300 billion dollars of sustainability bonds. These are bonds that are consistent with the UN's SDG or social they're concerned with social concerns, right? Mm-hmm. Or change, for example. So these are ongoing, and they are very active. I think Security Bank just recently floated its own domestic bond, oversubscribed. What else? Mega World also. And so these are welcome developments. So you want a more active capital market, domestic capital market.
Mm-hmm. But Gov, how much is too much?
Well, I think we're still, we're just starting. So I don't think it is going to be a threat to the economy. Because as you know, our debt to GDP ratio is pretty on the low side compared to what is acceptable in the market. Mm-hmm. And so unlike other emerging economies, we can afford to still float both on the government side and the private sector side bonds that are meant to maybe even strengthen the conglomerates or the banks, and for them to invest more into social and environmental projects.
Mm-hmm. Last week, Gov, the central bank also excluded debt securities from the single borrower's limit rule. I understand that rule says the bank should limit its lending to a single client to only 25% of capital. What material impact do you expect this to have?
Now, on the SBL, we actually, as part of our response to the COVID pandemic, we earlier expanded the SBL from 25 to 30%. Mm-hmm. Now, recently, in connection with your question, we excluded debt securities acquired from market making activities. This is part of our commitment to contribute to capital market development. So we recognize that market makers have a critical role, mm-hmm, in the functioning of the market. And with this relief, we expect that more dealing participants will take a more active role in market making. Mm-hmm. The new policy will give them sufficient time to offload their securities position without going beyond their loan exposure ceilings. So, mm-hmm, we allow them to, we exempt them for as of loans from August 1st to July 31 next year, 90 days. And after August, by August 1st next year onwards, it will be for 60 days. So this is part of our desire to incentivize dealing participants to be more active in market making, mm-hmm, to put market liquidity.
Gov, I know you've been very busy with roadshows for investors. Are there any low-hanging fruits that you can take advantage of as we try to arrest the drop in foreign direct investments? We do know that FDI net inflows for the first 4 months of the year fell by a third to just $1.9 billion.
Well, I just participated with Secretary Dominguez this month. We talked with about 50 investors, Japanese investors, mm-hmm, and then there's another one scheduled early next month, today's July, right? Mm-hmm. August 7th. Mm-hmm. This will involve the treasurer and my deputy, and then sometime also. I think on the third week of August, I will have another engagement with institutional investors from various jurisdictions in advance, this time organized by Nomura. And so I'll tell you, we have a lot of invitations from investor to investor conference calls being received by BSP and other economic officials. And this only shows keen interest of investors across the globe in the Philippines amid the global COVID-19 crisis. Mm-hmm. We're very optimistic that I think with the impending recovery, because we're starting to open up the economy, there will be a lot of foreign investors coming in. We know that FDI will have a hit this year. FDI will probably, our forecast is will go down to about 4.2 billion this year, mm-hmm. from 2.6 last year. But we expect the FDIs to increase to about $6.6 billion by 2021.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Gov, we're obviously going through a much more difficult second half of the year. Are you seeing any fiscal cliffs upon us?
No, the most difficult quarter is the second quarter. We passed that. I think we're now on the rebound states. I see the recovery is like a Nike swoosh, mm-hmm. like that, right? Mm-hmm. We passed the second quarter was the most difficult quarter. I think we're now looking at a maybe less negative or a slightly positive third quarter. We will probably have a very nice Christmas, mm-hmm. and then onwards to 2021. It's a strong recovery in 2021.
Mm-hmm. Given Given this slightly positive outlook that you're keeping, are you thinking that maybe you won't have to pull the trigger again for the rest of the year?
I think I've been quoted as saying that the current monetary stance can hold for the next few quarters, and I'm positive that it will be what we have done right now is sufficient. I remember right, we have released into the system some 1.3 trillion pesos. Mm. That's equivalent to 6.7% of GDP. Mm. So let's see what whether we need to do something more. But we just keep our sight into our regional program for BSP, which is bringing BSP closer to the people. And that means financial inclusion, more digitalization, which has been accelerated, mm-hmm. out of this pandemic. So that's still our program: low and stable inflation, a sound and robust budget, or rather banking system, and a safe and reliable payments and settlement system. Those are our goal for BSP, and we remain committed to those goals.
Okay, on that note, thank you very much, Governor Ben, for joining us this morning.